Good afternoon. The institution of none and all is a religion that studies religion in global total as a practice. That is our purpose. That is what we do. I myself am the dude. And despite an abundance of personal religious interactions and studies and experiences, I have a degree in religious studies, a degree in humanities, and 2 degrees in anthropology. On top of that, I was born as an Orthodox Mormon to a Mormon family in the 80s and 90s, Southern California. If you know anything about Orthodox Mormonism in that area at that time, the people who practice it at a high level are some of the most driven and organized and effective people that you've ever seen. Let me give you an example of life growing up in my home as a child. You get up at 3 a.m. every morning and do a paper route because it's a job and everybody has to have lots of jobs and make lots of money all the time. So that you can spend it on a very proper Victorian inspired English WASP lifestyle. Keeping up with the Joneses, right? You got to keep up with the Joneses for things to keep up with the people next door, right? Okay. So the Mormon system is very insulated. It's very complicated. It's very socialized, and it really represents a culture within a culture in a pluralistic relationship with the United States and the secular culture, or the opposite, not opposite, but differing religious cultures in the area at the time. But just to say that Mormons, you know, like I was saying, my family up, do the paper route, then scripture study from 5 a.m. to 6 a.m., then older children go to seminary from 6 to 7 while younger kids eat breakfast and get ready. Then, you know, everybody is out the door by 7 o'clock, 7:30 to make it to school and, you know, go through that day. And then at the end of that day, you come home, and on Monday night you have a family home evening, and on Tuesday night you have mutual, and on Wednesday night you have visiting teaching, and on Thursday night you have scouts, and on, you know, whatever, it's like Friday night there's the ward function, and on Saturday you have a church dance and a youth group activity in the afternoon, and on Sunday you go back to church. So it's an entire lifestyle on top of living in the world, going to school, going to work, being a person. Very, very driven, very, very, very constantly reading, constantly praying, constantly all of these things. And by the time I was 10, by the time I was 5, let's put it this way, this is something Richard Dawkins doesn't think is possible, whatever, I had realized that it was bullshit for reasons that I'm going to go into in another video another time. By the time I was 10, by the time I was 5, I had also realized that Tai Chi was the key to all things in the universe. By the time I was 10, I had found the Tao and read it for the first time. By the time I was 20, I had read the Tao dozens of times and read the Bhagavad Gita, I had read the Dhammapada, I had then, you know, I had laid myself a basic introduction to all forms of spirituality, religion, etc. By the time I was 25, I was a completely religious junkie, consuming everything I could find, and that's when I went back to school. By that time, I had read so many scriptures, it's unbelievable. And even started attending church at other places, and always conversating with people on what they believe, where they're from, what are their traditions, what are their forms, what are their ways of doing things. Long story short, 5 minutes into this, I'm announcing my credentials for giving this talk. Okay, this is effectively similar to an academic lecture, and I'm telling you that I don't have a PhD and I'm not a freaking neuroscientist like Sam Harris, and I haven't written, well, I have written enough material for several books, but I haven't published anything yet. And I don't even know if I want to or plan to, because I am somebody who is keenly aware of the aesthetics of asceticism, and with that in place, I have no desire or make no effort to further myself in the system of men that I also sometimes refer to as mammon. I don't want to succeed in the world. I have no interest in doing that, but no one can stop me from coming on YouTube and delivering a lecture like this. So I'm just saying, internet, beware. There are, when any time you're going to to begin a discussion on religion and what religion is and what it means to the world or how we're going to approach it, and today we're going to approach it in a very specific way. We're going to examine the articulation between the church and the state, which is a popular topic of interest on the internet, at least from what I've seen on Reddit and Facebook, etc. But I am geared toward these types of things. I'm sure if you played video games on those all day long, you wouldn't even be seeing this now, and right? To begin a discussion on religion requires a accurate and complete definition of the term religion. Religion actually, as a word, has an etymology, and it actually does mean something. The meaning of that sometimes is up for debate, especially if you look on Wikipedia. But according to the academic community that I've studied under, there is no debate. Religion means to connect, to attach, to bind together. It means to make two one. It means to make two things one thing. That's what it means at the etymology of the word. It means to connect one thing to another thing for a purpose. So it doesn't always have to be, you know, a transcendent or immanent union. It can be as simple as hooking an ox to a cart with a yoke, right? That's actually also the definition of the word yoga. And there's a whole interesting set of comments that can be made and should be made about the progression and evolution of language in human societies, but real quick, just to give you the backbone primer of that discussion, Pali Sanskrit is the root language of almost all the other languages on the old continent of Asia, Africa, and Europe. That's all connected. You can walk from one side to the other. People have swam the English Channel. It's easy enough to get through in canoes. Like, seriously, you don't have to be able to sail around the world to get from Scotland to Japan. Really, you don't. You need a canoe, like, twice from Scotland to Japan. You know what I'm saying? From Scotland to the mainland, from the mainland to Japan, you can walk the rest of the way. The religion has moved along language. All cultural transmissions happen on veins, or nerves, just like your body sends all of its energetic pulses through a system, a network, a tree, a phylogeny, if you will, of nervous bundles that carry the impulses. Culture travels on specific routes. The geographical physical route by which culture has usually traveled is waterways, and you can observe that as an anthropologist. There's all kinds of work on it. If you want to go and delve into it, you're welcome to. And it's some of it's fascinating and some of it's not. But at any rate, I've looked at a wide selection of it. So the other way that culture travels in a abstract form that doesn't exist in time and space necessarily, at least it has to be abstractly linked to time and space. It does not directly exist in time and space in a physical form that can be materially recorded until the invention of language. It is language, all right? Culture moves with language. Languages carry ideas. Languages carry all the forms. Everything happens through language. Language is the vehicle by which knowledge and information is transmitted from one place to the other in this world amongst human people. Anthropologically, that's an undisputable statement, and there's even some debate over whether biologically the definition of language needs to be expanded, but that's getting too complicated for some people, maybe right off the bat. But let's stick with the definition of religion. We're 11 minutes in and we're just getting to the very beginning. This is serious stuff, folks. And I protect this house, you know what I'm saying? I am the Under Armour, okay? Sam Harris, buddy, you're a neuroscientist. I'm sorry if you're watching this video, if you're not watching this video, if you're a Sam Harris fan, if you're not a Sam Harris fan, you're either going to love it or you're going to hate it. This is the fact of the matter, pal. You became invested in religion since September 11th, and so you have about the narrowest definition of religion that can possibly exist on the planet. And interestingly enough, it's the definition that is shared by the vast majority of people I experience on the internet, who could at least be defined as the new atheist crowd for sure. But there's an undercurrent of new atheism sweeping through both the information sphere, the digital sphere. I don't even know what you would call it. I'm not that. I'm on computer every day, and I don't even know what your lingo is. See, I don't make judgments on computers. I study religion. Here we go, Sam Harris. This is your definition of religion. It's radical Islam and fundamentalist Christianity. That's the Sam Harris definition of religion. It's the narrowest definition. All religion is radical Islam and fundamentalist Christianity. Buddhism's not a religion, it's a philosophy. Hinduism is a foreign word that you don't even know what it means. Everything that has come out of religion, just to give you an example, yoga studios and martial arts studios, as an example, just an example, are not examples of religion. Sports are not an example of religion. No one can have a religion personally themselves. We don't ever talk about Jews because the Holocaust is horrible, and then you have radical Islam and fundamentalist Christianity, and that's religion on planet Earth. It's narrow, 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 narrow. It doesn't even explore other forms of Islam and other forms of Christianity, and it has absolutely nothing to say about the depth of those systems as meme generators, if you want to call it that, as metaphorical starting points for teaching children as epistemologies for life. And in many cases, some of those are outdated, they're too ancient, they haven't been upgraded, they're not in flux with the modern world we live in, so they're unsatisfactory, and like that's a great point to make. Thanks for pointing that out, Sam Harris. But so that's the Sam Harris definition of religion, as narrow as it gets. Radical Islam and fundamentalist Christianity. Here's an anthropological definition of religion. Anthropology is synonymous with religion. Religion is synonymous with basically everything people do, and even if you can start to separate pieces of what people are doing from the greater branching tree of what religion is, those things were incubated and birthed, and they began with religion, and they're only going to reproduce more religion. Religion is synonymous with or superior to, which means it's either the same as or higher than, greater than, just as Pali Sanskrit is greater than English. Religion is greater than anthropology, art, culture, science, etc., everything. Okay, Religion is the sum total of everything that human beings have ever done, put themselves toward, believed in. It is the story of humanity on planet Earth, period. And you have to take all of that into account to even begin to speak of it. Now, obviously, to some people, that looks like an infinite set of infinite sets. And I can understand how you would feel that way, Sam Harris. To me, a brain looks like, a big, mushy lump of rotting meat. You know what I'm saying? I wouldn't understand why anyone would ever try to go inside of their head to get at it or take one out to get at it. It just, I make no comment on neuroscience, by the way. But here's the thing. As far as religion goes, I've been all over it for 35 years, basically. And I've been drinking it in and soaking it up with such voracity. And that's because, in my opinion, I am spiritually aware of my path through the transmigration of my soul in incarnation upon incarnation upon incarnation in reality. You can take that for what it's worth. I understand you may not understand it, but I'm just saying it makes me qualified to look at the entire subject. Okay? That's all. That's all I'm saying. That's all I'm saying. I'm making one claim. I'm saying, hey, I'm a credible source on this. All right, so let's skip ahead. Today we're going to talk about religion in terms of not this ivory tower, not this academic speculative clusterfuck of information that the mind can pull out. Let's talk about religion in reality, okay? And in reality, in hard, underlining total reality in the United States, there's a definition for religion which is legally binding, right? In other words, the people who have created that definition will kill you or throw you into a cage. They will threaten violence upon you. They will remove you from their system if you don't do what they allow, right? There's regardless of what anybody thinks about freedom or what level of it you have a group of people in place who are ready to threaten you with legitimized authoritative violence if you break their rules, right? So there is something called a legal definition of religion. And where it exists is in the tax code. And so the term, the status, the address that is proper for this legal status of being a religious body, of being an accepted religion, of being a religion that is recognized. It's called 501c3. 501c3. 501c3's tax status, it means you are a religion and that you can operate as such. Now, as my lawyer has already made me aware of something that I have long been aware of, because I started studying this part of the tax code when I was much younger than I am now, there's a strict rule in the 501c3 tax status application that any group, any organization, any corporation of people, a corporation makes money, but it's a corporate body, right? It exists in physical form and it has objectives that it wants to achieve. Any group that wants to call themselves a religion has to have this 501c3 tax status. So just for example, I'll give you some examples of a group that has the 501c3 tax status as far as I understand it. It's the Freedom From Religion Foundation. The Freedom From Religion Foundation is I believe that if it didn't start online, it definitely owes a great deal of its support to a well-executed online network and advertising program of sorts, information dissemination program. basically. They have an online empire built up to support their tax-free enterprise. And like I said, the stipulation in the 50, I don't think I said it, I think I rambled right past it. The stipulation in the 501c3 tax status that my lawyer made me aware of and that I've known since I studied it is that you cannot endorse political campaigns or whatever. That's the rule that you can't follow. And the Freedom From Religion Foundation, if you're aware and are following up, by the way, just some quick background information on the Freedom From Religion Foundation, where I was going. They are they're a 501c3. They obviously do petition the government as part of what they do. The reason that they can do that is because the government has, for at least a certain amount of time, and kind of historically, always overlooked forcing religions to actually stay out of politics. It's not practiced. And there are reasons why that practice is the way it is. And there are better reasons than, conspiracy theories involving Masonic cult organization of all other religious groups in the United States. Here's a very simple one. First of all, religious groups do things that the government would otherwise have to do without them. They also provide the government with a certain amount of legitimacy because if you understand the breakdown of cultural institutions in Western society and really in all society, cultural institutions break down into these certain discrete forms, and no matter where they occupy, whatever demographic shifts they may occupy in terms of the public trust that's placed in them or whatever, they complement each other. They work together. They're as powerful as each other. And so you can see things like in places where the governments are completely corrupt, people want religious guarantees on the institutional rule of people. And where religions are completely corrupt, people want secular guarantees on the institutions of that dominate society. So we're dealing with this. The other reason that, another really, really good reason, this is actually the best reason that religions, even though they are ordered to stay out of politics, they can't, is because politics affect the world, and religion, it is the condition of the world falls within the stewardship of religion. Whether you're non, if you wanted to identify yourself as non-religious, I could actually go all night with you and try to point out that you are, and you could find out a whole list of like cultural DNA patterns that are indicative of a religious background for you. No matter who you are, I could do that with you, guarantee you. But some people consider them to be irreligious because they take a narrow Sam Harris definition. They say, hey, I'm not a radical Muslim and I'm not a fundamentalist Christian, therefore I'm not religious. At any rate, see, there's a difference between religion as an idea that occupies space in the human condition versus religion as a space that is only occupied geographically on land, right? We talked about that. Rivers versus language and theoretical interpretations, metaphorical, analytical, right? This is all language. These are all interpretations of the condition of our souls, the condition of our being, who we are as people, right? That is a religious question. That has to do with religious implications. Largely, we try, there are always efforts to reduce it away from religion, psychology, sociology, philosophy, etc. These all basically still continue to deal with information that's largely put up and informed by a discourse that's created in and patterns that identify as religious, but to take the meaning and the, you know, the analysis out, at the process of the analysis out of the hands of the religious groups and put them into more secular terms, whatever that is. And often religion becomes a catch-all for any kind of terms that are used to describe any of this that are unfamiliar to someone else, right? And the more unfamiliar than they get, then they become cultish, right? So back to the FFRF, back to the tax statuses. Churches are in the world. They have to care about what's going on around them. They have to try to inform people as to what kind of decisions they make. And these days, what decisions aren't political? Everything's political. And so we're all trapped in this soup, in this milieu, this mosaic pattern. And especially in today's world, it's totally postmodern. There's no more boundaries. There's no more clear lines. It's everything has just disintegrated into itself, and we have a foundation of sand to work with, and nothing's clear. Nothing's clear to anyone. Okay, everything's debatable. Everything's arguable. Everything has evidence for it. It's just a never-ending, infinite set of infinite sets. We talked about that earlier. So, how is it possible that a group who has a 501c3 status, the Freedom From Religion Foundation, has a 501c3 status, and they are using that to persuade politics to tax religious groups? If you understand, the Freedom From Religion Foundation just issued a lawsuit. It is a lawsuit. It's not like a lawsuit. To the federal government, basically suing that the IRS start to enforce the tax code, which is a logistical nightmare that's totally unaccomplishable. It would be like launching a new war on drugs, all right? And there would be even less of, it would be an intellectual war on drugs. It would be a war on drugs of ideas, right? All of a sudden, you'd have to have all of these dudes in paramilitary equipment going around, spies in churches, spies everywhere religious groups existed. We'd have to have like all this public vetting of who's got 501c3 status and how much money did any of those organizations pull in the last little while. Excuse me, I'll take a drink. So, logistically, what they're asking for is a nightmare that honestly would, it would cripple the federal government. It would cripple the IRS to attempt to try to enforce that tax code. And it would cripple the legal system trying to define and figure out where to draw that line. The point of all of this, kind of roundaboutly 30 minutes in to this little lecture, is that taxing churches as a violation of the separation of church and state is kind of a ridiculous idea to even be grounded in. The separation of church and state is a myth. It amazes me that people can have so much disdain for mythical narratives and have never subscribed to critical thinking long enough to realize how many mythical narratives they subscribe to. There is no separation of church and state. The First Amendment of the Constitution of the United States is rumored to contain a separation of church and state, but actually what it contains is a Tai Chi of church and state. It's a separation and a unity. It locks and fuses church and state together in such a way that they cannot be separated. And so the privileged status that is given to religious bodies, and if you understood the safeguards to freedom that are in the constitution of all of these liberal societies in the 1700s and how they came about and why especially the United States ended up with the one that they ended up with, being an English-speaking nation, therefore modeling theirs largely on the English-speaking nation that is not the sum total of all the factors that come into their creation, but have played the most significant role, right? English formulation of government, first of all, assumes what had already been determined from thousands of years of natural evolution of human beings in their response patterns to governance. Humans created religion as a response to government. Religion was always a response. It is an activity that people undertake as a revolutionary act. People create religion. Religion is created in every single sense by a social reformer. If you look at all of the six major religions of the world, social reform is what the avatar of each one of them is aiming at. Okay? Lao Tzu, Taoism, social reform. Hinduism is a little bit stickier. We're going to have to withdraw Hinduism from that statement, actually. Because Hinduism is the oldest. Like I said, the first language is Pali-Sanskrit. So there are individual levels of where that happens within Hinduism, actually, that would have to be then re-separated out. And there's so many of those. Gandhi's the latest one, maybe. You know what I'm saying? He's really not. That woman who is all about the seed banks and stuff is the latest one, probably. At any rate, I forgot her name. But anyways, this is what I'm saying. So we'd have to pull Hinduism out of it. But Siddhartha and the creation of Buddhism as a subset of Hinduism is also one of those. So there you go. And Jesus, obviously, Muhammad, obviously, and Moses. Even though Moses is often thought of as a mythical narrative, he's a legendary character. Someday, even Muhammad will be a legendary character. Peace be upon him. Blessings to the Prophet. I say that knowing that that's just how people do it. That's the older something gets, the more it's disconnected to the reality of the time that is, you know, actually now. So the separation of church and state is the state. The church was created as a response to the state. Religion was the tool that the state needed to use to seize power in the first place, absolutely. But the old religions of the old world, like Hinduism, would really be like one of the last vestigial, and Taoism kind of too. Those two are old enough to be on that cusp of that transitionary period, right? And then obviously, you know, Marie Hagenbuta's work on what can only, in modern terms, be called a pagan complex over Europe, and the relationship that had to, you know, the guys who had the fire, who were on Fire Mountain, wherever that was, whoever had the dogs and lots of women and lots of strong men together, they had to create, you know, a narrative that drove strong symbolic information into the hearts and minds of all of the people in their land. So these are kind of the old institutional religions, and today you think of these other religions as institutional religions, and the reality is that these religions are social reformation religions. They're not institutional religions. They're revolutionary to the institution religions. Oh man, the things Sam Harris doesn't understand about the subject of religion. Woo! So the Freedom From Religion Foundation is suing the government. They are themselves 501c3 exempt. And they're suing the government to tax churches. The government could never do this. And that's the First Amendment does not separate church and state. All it does is it tells Congress not to favor any certain group over any other. And it also tells Congress that they can not favor the absence of those groups as well. It's a none and all statement, really it is. And so it guarantees freedom of and from at the same time. Wow, locking it down. Sam Harris doesn't understand how Jesus could be God in Christianity and just a man in Islam. Most Christians don't even understand that Jesus is in Islam. And Sam Harris, have you ever gone so far as to understand that the Hadith, in its depiction of Muhammad's night ascension and the great dream above the Dome of the Rock, who's sitting at the head of the table there? His name's Yeshua bin Yusuf, all right? That's all I got to say. It doesn't matter what you think, Sam Harris. It's a nuanced, sophisticated, dynamic, complex, comprehensive milieu of mosaic patterns that sometimes, in fact, almost always, often, are changing according to the whims and the opinions of whoever is in charge of expressing them. Okay? There's no absolute to it, but when you study all of it, the absolutes rise up out of a thing, and then you can make, larger general conversational topics, talking points. You can say things about it. You can make statements, man. You're not qualified to make statements, man. All right, so basically, the Freedom From Religion Foundation, I just want to let you know, if you go check them out on Facebook and you argue with them at all, they will block you. They talk a good game about trying to encourage a debate, but they let it be known, they are as dogmatic as anyone ever, and they are fundamentalists to the core. And if you look into the organization at its core level, the people who started the Freedom From Religion Foundation are ex, probably opportunist pastors of Presbyterian or whatever, Presbyterian or, did I just say the same thing twice? I don't know how many of these things there are, but like, they're Presbyterianism is interesting because there's a division in, like there are in most of the major branches of institutionalized Christianity in the United States, there are divisions between the conservative version versus the liberal version. So there are clear differences between Presbyterians who are liberal and who are conservative. You probably didn't know that. At any rate, this has all been very interesting, and I don't think it made any point other than Sam Harris is not qualified to speak on this subject. I am. The legal status of religions in the United States is a 501c3. That makes the Freedom From Religion Foundation a religion. The whole idea that you can tax the churches is totally untenable. There's no way to execute that. You want to, in this time, right now, you want to guarantee that the United States is going to rip itself to pieces, try to tax the churches. That's a good idea, actually. The myth of the separation of church and state is ridiculous. The real institutional state always has to use the religion to bolster it and prop it up. All of the religions of today that are thought to be institutional religions are actually revolutionary social reformations. Those social reformations led to a formulation of a religious government that respects the right of the individual to choose their conscience and their belief patterns for themselves. If we wipe that out, you don't have that power anymore, and you've just laid the way to a horrible, 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 horrible vetting and purging cultural shift. And China knows what that's all about. You can check your history with them. I say this, Christianity Christianity. You want to understand something about Christianity? Christianity was designed for tax evasion in the first place. That's something that is going to be another discussion for another day. But if you talk to people at the West Star Institute, which is a group, an international body of the top scholars in all of the academic pursuits that study primary sources in their original languages. I'm talking about this, baby. These guys are archaeologists and linguists who read Greek. They read Aramaic. They read Hebrew. They are looking at these codexes under glass in museums with special permission and getting their work from that, okay? And they write papers. They have a journal. They have a sem. They have a convocation. What is it called? I keep wanting to say a seminary, and that's not what the name of it is. A symposium. That's not what the name of it is. It's a seminar. It's a seminar. It's not a seminary. It's a seminar. Can see why I got mixed up. Anyways, and they aren't in complete unison, but they all more or less agree that Christianity started as a method of tax evasion. Bottom line is, once we get into this game, you're going to find out that this whole thing's going to change, and we'll talk about that next.